By the Trump administration not only yielded harm to the people on the ground, but moreover yielded harm to the larger majority of the United States. This is something which is important, because this shows you that us giving presidents the ability, or the presidential administration, the ability to engage in things such as capital policies can be harmful to the people on the ground. This is the people which we should be caring for. This is the people which are most important in looking to these. So in my speech today, I'm going to show you why that is the case under the following points, right? One, when do we usually give, why do we want to, the upcoming presidential administration to do this, but moreover, how we then advance the democratic principles that exist in the countries such as USA, but moreover, ladies and gentlemen, why we want these individuals on the ground to have an independent voice, regardless of what the administration says, right? So first, ladies and gentlemen, let's just get to the problem. We think that the problem here exists, ladies and gentlemen, when policies or capital policies are implemented and the man on the ground are implemented without the consent of the man on the ground, right? This is important because if it largely affects them, they need to play a part in such policies. No, thank you, right? But two, ladies and gentlemen, we think this is then problematic, right? In terms of it extending to people who didn't even vote for that very administration, right? For people people who didn't even vote for the Trump administration. This is something which is important to consider. So firstly, what do we mean by capitalists, right? We think that here these key domestic socio-economic policies on things such as healthcare, things such as economics, things such as abortion, which already exist in the Trump administration. But two, what is the referendum, right? We think that here it's a public vote which is given to the general majority of that public, or the general people in that society. The very same referendum which is run in the Brexit vote, we run it the same way, right?
Yes.
But two, ladies and gentlemen, what we think that here, what do we mean by repeal, right? We think that here we allow, after this referendum, we'd remove such policies and after that, in within the coming administration, right? So here, the criteria to base today's debate on is when do we use, when do we give power or power to the people through referendum, right? One, ladies and gentlemen, in instances where people of that country suffer the dangers of capstone policies, but moreover, ladies and gentlemen, when the administration has showed the ability to apply that capstone policy in a democratic society, right? Mm-hmm. So first point, right, which is why do you think that firstly the incoming presidential administration should do this, right? And here, ladies and gentlemen, we think that here these administrations already exist. Exist to push the push ideas which people who have voted them in. Right?
Yes.
But yeah, important to consider is the obligation that exists, because they do not only serve the people who voted them in,
yes,
but moreover serve the people generally in that country. Right? Which means that if you vote for ANC, your ANC's part, and if you don't vote for ANC's, ANC's policies still affect you, even if you didn't vote for them. This is the sole obligation which you should extend this policy to, and this is something which is important to consider. And here, let's just get to my first point, which is the democratic principles and why we want to advance the democratic principles. And here, the conclusion is that we get more advancement of that democracy, right? So here, it's important to consider two things, right? One, participation, meaningful participation in that way, but two, the accountability then that exists under the sort of model. And here, ladies and gentlemen, under the first idea of participation, we want participation to exist legislatively in these countries.
Yes.
What does this mean? One, ladies and gentlemen, we want people to be meaningfully represented, but moreover, not just meaningfully represented, but to ask for us to make it a law that people engage in such things. Why is this essentially important, right? One, ladies and gentlemen, we tell you that here it is important because now we give people on the ground the ability to meaningfully engage with politics which affect them, but more, ladies and gentlemen, if that is in that context, we would give them we would extend that participation. But two, ladies and gentlemen, the challenge that when they express their views in terms of meaningfully engaging and what's happening in within that country, this is important to consider because people in like USA did not have a say when the Obamacare was taken out, and this is something which is important to do, right? So firstly, thank you. Secondly, this idea of accountability and why we want accountability, right? Here, ladies and gentlemen, we tell you that governments cannot just go on doing what they feel or like what they please, right? Because here, what you have to understand is that when they enact policy, it does not only affect their voters, it affects like other voters too. And this is why it makes it this is why it's more legitimate for us to do this thing, right? But two, how we then achieve accountability? That now, since people can actually tell the government when this is wrong and how this is wrong, we would want something like a system like that, like for people or like for people to tell the Trump administration when they're doing wrong and like how to fix it. We tell you that that's what meaningful engagement about portraying and furthering such ideas and our engage further.
Do the comparative. Why are so many elections insufficient?
Yes.
Why are so many elections insufficient?
We don't have to do that, right? What we just have to show you, ladies and gentlemen, is that this is something which is justified in terms of us like doing a public referendum. Second idea, which is why we want these people to have an independent voice, regardless of what is happening, right? And here, ladies and gentlemen, we have to understand the nature of the nature of action of the capstone policy. We tell you that here they do not they harm the person on the ground. Why is this important to consider? One, ladies and gentlemen, we tell them that when it directly affects them, in principle, should already be giving them like the ability to engage in them, right? But two, more above and beyond that, ladies and gentlemen, we tell them that if it sets a harmful precedent in that sort of country, then we would allow for them to have an independent voice and do things such as a referendum, and this is something which is important to consider. Ladies and gentlemen, within today's debate, we need to have meaningful engagement with governments who enact policies which harm the person on the ground, and I'm really proud to propose.
Why Jozi Rumble ends for opening government is because they refuse to understand the burden in today's debate. Why are elections that are already being held insufficient, right? That absolutely is their prerogative. Why is this the case? Because this is a change debate, and elections are fucking expensive, right? What happens when you hold an election is that someone like Hillary Clinton, right, who comes from the Democrats, might have certain policies regarding healthcare, but she needs corporate funding, right? Now you need two elections. Firstly, Hillary needs to get there, and then she needs to repeal the laws from the older administrations to push her policy prerogative and do the change that her constituency wants, right? So at the end of the day, there's more influence of corporates because she needs the money. And by the way, the point that they give, right, here are the harms analysis they have. Firstly, they say the problem is that when the ANC wins, the DA don't get their policies, right? What's the problem with that? The ANC policy is mutually exclusive to the DA policy, right? It's either one or it's either the other. And they decide that based on the general election, right? The DA stands for free market and neoliberalism, and the ANC has the Freedom Charter, right? They make that way up in that election. What's the need for a subsequent referendum, right? Then this guy says that they repealed Obamacare. Joke's on him, they haven't repealed Obamacare, but I get the example, right? The problem is, if you voted for Trump, you consented for that repeal. That was practically the entire Republican campaign. And then Mfumo was like, no, you need to show that in your speech, right? Because I'm pretty sure the defining aspect of the initial campaign are the policies, right? You vote for Republican if you wanted the repeal. You voted for Democrat if you wanted the amendment, right? That was an explicit way up made at the point at which you chose to vote for a party, right? You busted it by not telling us why that extraction of consent is insufficient. Second fallacy we get from opening government. Yeah, referenda are instances of direct democracy. But more democracy is not necessarily a better democracy or a better democratic state, because the cost of the election cripples and bankrupts the ruling party and their corporate funders, which means they need more funding, right? They need more corporates weighing in. But the problem is that if you're talking about healthcare, right, let's say that the Democrats win. Are they likely to get the corporate funding for a repeal or for a replacement of healthcare that's going to bankrupt healthcare industries, to bankrupt hospital industries? And the same corporate individuals who then have to fund a candidate twice have the ability to make the presidential candidate, especially in the US, who are inimical to their policies, a sitting duck, right? So if Democrats were elected in the US, the corporates that would fund them would find ways by pumping massive amounts of money into the second referendum that make them a lame duck. You give them the potential to undermine the prerogative of the administration, meaning that principally you give them that prerogative in the first election. If you didn't ventilate your policy well enough, the problem with the democracy is that you can't be in between. You either win or you either lose. Why is that extraction of consent not relevant, right? The last time I looked at elections, they discussed thoroughly the changes they wanted to make and people consented to them. What type of changes did you not hear about that you are likely to hear about in these referenda, right? It's very, very explicit. The only example he gives you and the only reason he gives you for spending massive amounts of money and increasing corporate influence is Obamacare. But everyone knew exactly what was going to happen to it when they appointed that presidential candidate. That was their prerogative. So the extraction of consent is sufficient. Why are the harms in today's debate incredibly serious? Because principally, you undermine the technocratic administration and efficiency, right? If you vote for Trump, and then Trump can't push his plan immediately to repeal the old administration's regime, there's a stagnancy in the electorate. You have an ailing economy and an ailing country without economic or policy direction, right? Then they need to host a referendum. Do you know how long the election takes? It takes months, but it also takes months of planning. Now there's a burnout. You need more and more money. You need more and more lobbying that goes on. You need more corporates. And that expense, that burnout that you get, the corporate selling out increases. The problem is that your administration is a lame duck during that referendum. You remove the ability for that administration to exercise their prerogative and show you why their policies are necessarily superior or the best. But then, the perversion comes in that when the electorate make a choice like Trump, we reject the principle that Trump can be made a lame duck president by another referendum that might be corporately sponsored to sabotage his administration, right? They made that way up in the first place. They wanted a repeal of Obamacare, not a replacement of Obamacare, and they voted as such. So right now, opening government has no change, right? What is the change that you want? Because more democracy is more expenses, it's more costs, it's more sabotaging of policy, and it's more time before the administration ends up rolling out their campaign, right? You have a finite amount of time to do that, and the longer you stay in stagnancy, the more money you spend on your own administration, on another person's policies, right? Those are all principles and fundamental tenets of democracy that they confiscate without a benefit, right? We are telling you it's about sabotaging the prerogative of the administration. It's about giving corporates incredible amounts of power. There's no benefit from your case, so you're likely to chow bottom half.
Do you think that civil liberties should be determined by the expediencies of money or the expediencies of lobbying?
Well, Jamie, here's the problem. The initial election already had lobbying. The problem is lobbying happens in every election. Now it happens twice, and you must represent yourself in the second one. So you need more corporate funding to get through that second electoral boundary. Because it's not just enough to get for Trump to fund a great campaign and become the candidate. He now needs to fund another campaign to push the policies, right? But he needs to speak about the policy in both of them, because he can't front himself as a straight white male, vote for me. He comes up with policies in the original draft. Now there's a change to policies because he needs more money to run and succeed in the next referenda. If Jamie is like, why should civil liberties be determined by lobbying? Why is the next referenda also not run by lobbyists, right? Why is the next referenda not suffering from the same democratic flaws of the first election? But what's the problem with OG's case? They say that the essential benefit is more engagement. I don't think so. I think if you voted ANC in the first election, you annoyed that you now need to vote for the ANC to get more power to do the thing you voted them in to do in the first place, right? People are more likely to be exceptionally annoyed by the fact that they're being pinged by campaign ads, that everyone wants to seduce them into a vote, they'd rather stand by their party, and this is what party loyalty is about, right? People will stand by Trump's policies because they voted for that initial policy discussion in the first place. We think that it's unlikely to bring any kind of change to what people support, right? Even though there might be incredible amounts of funding either way, that just means that you have to spend that money, right? The electoral change that they get is the same stagnation, right? If you voted ANC in the last election, you will vote for the policies of the ANC, because the common man on the ground can't determine economic policy and technocratic, like, efficiency. All he sees is ANC, Siya Jola, Siya Vuma, let's go. We in Wall Street, let's go. Siya Vuma, it means we agree, not the other one. So they're likely to endorse their party and endorse the initial choice that they made because it's about partisanship. It's not about technocratic policies. You don't isolate that by your model, but you bankrupt your parties. You force them to become stagnant administration, and you run the risk of a sitting duck president during the entire administration.
Okay, we thank the Leader of Opposition and call up the Deputy Prime Minister to continue with the debate.
Opposition has that we cannot support this motion is because it's going to take time and it's going to take money, right? They don't engage why this A is not necessary, but not B, that it doesn't achieve the efficacy that Molebogeng has spoken about in today's video, right? Molebogeng tells you about democratic principle, about the principle of participation, and it being a direct form of democratic principle at the end of the day. This becomes very important because what does that mean is that if Obama says if Trump says I'm gonna put a ban on Muslims, if Trump says I'm gonna build a wall on Mexico, if Trump says I'm gonna remove the Obamacare, which affects people within the state of America, we think that the people need a second referendum to go against that particular policies, right? Those inclinations are visible from these political administration, right? Whenever he tells you about the obligation that exists within these political political administration, the obligation no longer extends when they're incoming, the obligation no longer extends to their interest or the Democrats or what the other political parties there. The obligation now extends to the entirety of the country, right? And if the entirety of the country is not happy, who will push for this referendum? And we want to give people that particular power. We think that by your own way, by your own saying, Jozi ends here for you. Okay, so let's look at two issues of engagement, right? And note here, adjudicators and panels, that Waris concedes that direct democracy is important and concedes that direct democracy needs to be applied within this particular motion. This concession comes in two levels, right? One, in never recognizing, because nowhere does it defend that these repealing of these Capstone policies is an okay thing, right? Because if you don't show that these policies are okay and these policies must be applied, you actively concede logically so, right? That's the analysis we should have given into the debate. But even if that, we assume that what I just said now, that they don't concede, they still need to do the analytical work to then, how do we then best benefit the men on the ground who then get affected by this policy? How do we benefit the Muslims when how they are perceived within America? How do we benefit Mexicans when they get perceived? And the perception that say, you don't belong in this country because you belong to the other political party. We don't give that American a second chance to be able to vote at the end of the day, right? Then there's still Williams' view to say, why is terminal election not sufficient, right? Or insufficient, right? We say it is sufficient, right? We say that when they were running the organization, they were also not clear with all of these political interests that were pushing, right? We only knew about Trump's point of Trump's inclination of repealing Obama's care when he started tweeting on Twitter. Even Bill was disgusted about that about Trump's decision on Twitter, right? So that inclination, and remember, Trump is an individual, yes, I saw your tweet. Trump is an president, Trump was an incoming president within the state of America, right? So those inclinations shows that these policies are gonna happen at the end of the day. Those administration needs to come in, right? So what needs to come in? What we then need to do then is then we need to give power, or we need to give a second chance, and we're not saying the first election was insufficient. We're saying that the second election then was then created by this urgency of the incoming presidential administration, and we think we would rather have it in today's debate, right? We think that opening opposition hasn't told us, aside from the fact of expense, why this is not legitimate, which is what I'll analyze, right? Two things, right? Firstly, I'll look at the legitimacy of nationwide referendums and why we support it, right? But secondly, I will look at the obligation of presidential administration, and here looking at this terminal election, and this is what was my second point, why terminal elections were okay, but due to the agency of this incoming presidential administration, we would need a second election if it needs to be at the end of the day, right? One, this is the legitimacy, of national referendums, right? And here we need to look at, we need to do at this, what do these captive policies instill and what do they do? Firstly, we tell that they instill fear in people within that particular state. Fear within Mexicans, fear with exists within Muslims, within America, because of these inclinations by Trump and by his administration that they're pushing right now, right? This then, what this then does, Mr. Speaker, right? It then says, now it creates some sort of a perception around people, because these people are also individuals within the state of America, and they were participated in the second, in the first election, right? We then say that means that their lives are in danger, because once these captive policies are enacted, right, these policies then affect the very same people that they were aimed at wanting to affect at the end of the day, right? Muslims get a temporary ban and cannot access America. Mexicans get the war bill, and that creates the further ostracization that we don't want, right? But moreover, what this then does when inclinations are thrown out by incoming president, right? It then creates perceptions that and drives in exacerbates issues such as xenophobia, such as looking down on fellow Muslims, right? When now I see a Muslim person, if I'm in America, then that person is a potential to be a terrorist, because legislatively set by Trump, that person is more inclined to be a terrorist, and that is the particular problem that we don't want, right? But moreover, we then also look at black South Africans, and here they give an example of the ANC and an example of the DA, right? Mm-hmm. And here we look at other political parties and their inclination. Yes, DA has their own inclinations, and yes, ANC has their own inclinations about their policies, right? But once they get into power, they need to set policies or and further review those policies to benefit everyone at the end of the day, right? This is why BEE now has moved on to broad-based economic empowerment, because they recognize that these policies affect the men on the ground, and they need to be inclusive of everyone by the virtue of the mandate that we're giving to them at the end of the day.
That's
we can't take you. Yes, Bill.
Give it a full 15 seconds. This motion is about repealing policies. Yes. Policies that take years of specialist knowledge to consolidate overnight. It could mean that if a conservative administration comes into power, a liberal country can have progressive policies like gay rights repealed overnight.
What? Lies. But number two, these laws that were set by people long time ago to actively discriminate people within that particular crowd, right? But moreover, even if those laws, we have to repeal those laws, we would repeal those laws. But we want also to consider also the laws that might then also be the inclination to be removed. Laws like the Obama healthcare, laws like the ban on Mexico, right? These are laws that are about to come out from the incoming president, right? You cannot want to argue the debate on the fact of penalties only, ignoring the fact that this is a new incoming presidential administration that has interest and certain inclination that they want to prove within society. And as a result, we would want to give them the power, right? At the end of the day, right, we need to also look at then what does referendum mean, and then at the end of the day, and what does this then drive the change that we want, right? And here we also look at the last question, does it drive the change that we want? We look at the reason, firstly, why we want to give the people this particular referendum, right? Because remember that by obligation to actually means for a presidential presidential administration is supposed to represent everyone, and this, the interest of everyone needs to be taken care of at the end of the day, right? So if you care about the people on the ground, if you care about ensuring that no laws are also set to further marginalize and further discriminate people within states, you definitely side with the government. This motion must stand.
Okay, this house thanks the Deputy Prime Minister, and we call up the Deputy Leader of Opposition to finish off closing hard.
Opening governance policies are very much like the food that we get fed in today's debate. It makes me sick, and what do I decide to do? Have some more, maybe it'll make me feel better. We tell you that fundamentally the biggest harm of our democracy is still consistent with their model. We tell you that not only do you have the same problems consistent in the second election, but you haven't changed anything. You're only getting sicker. That's why I don't eat another burger. I just leave it alone at just that one, right? So we think that fundamentally they've lost today's debate because they've assumed that this referendum will breed different results, right? We tell you there are like two reasons why they're wrong, right? First of all, we still think that the inherent bipartisanship of like referendums is inherent in the elections, right? Whether you're arguing about like Obamacare, whether you're arguing about like the Affordable Care Act, the wording is very important. And I'll talk about why language control is incredibly important to referendums and skews referendum results, right? But second of all, we tell you that like the fact that you call it Obamacare means that like 100% of Republicans are like, fuck this policy, right? We say that that's the problem with referendum. We still have bipartisanship, no response, right? The second thing is that even if like they're not bipartisanship, we still think that like identity politics still covers the political spectrum, right? Handle your phone. Like the idea that like in terms of political conservativeness, like people would just still vote the same lines in terms of like the political spectrum. And so if people are largely liberal in the first election, they would vote exactly the same way. You haven't accounted for why we're spending more time, why we're spending more money in terms of the election where you have the exact same right. No, thank you, sir. Right? So like let's look at the idea of like how effective this model is. So we got both the example of like Obamacare, right? Like first of all, Obamacare wasn't repealed, but the understanding or like what they missed from Morrison's speech, right? And like the extension from Morrison's speech is that this the fact that Obamacare wasn't repealed says two things. One, that you need robust engagement in terms of not only repealing a motion, but also replacing it, right? We tell you that that's also something that is inherent in the status quo, something that doesn't need changing, right? And we tell you that like we don't need referendums to have good policy because you can debate them in Congress. Haven't shown us why necessarily we need better governments, right? But also the second thing is that we tell you that like people make decisions voting on the ticket, right? Literally, Trump spent 18 months telling us that he's going to build a wall and he's going to repeal and replace Obamacare. We say that's pretty offensive in telling you what the policies are, right? Do you even watch CNN? Okay, so like we tell you that like fundamentally, the identity politics and even the political spectrum in the first election encompasses the entire model. You haven't told us why specifically we need to do that, right? So, no, thank you, right? But also, they haven't engaged with the idea of repeal, right? So first of all, we don't think that they need to offer any alternatives. Yes. We say that all you need to do is electioneer on hatred, right? We say that all you need to do is paint or overcast your opposition as the bad guy, and then win, right? That doesn't mean that we get proper governance. That doesn't mean that we get the best model. That means that you also undercut the technocrats who spent 20, 30 years trying to come up with an economic model that doesn't fuck the poor, right? We say that that's why we'd rather have the first election so we don't spend money, and we also empower the presidential prerogative that is backed up by technocrats and not by populist movements like Boris Johnson, who literally fucked up the Britain by saying, oh yeah, let's leave Brexit, and didn't actually recover afterwards, right? We tell you that populism is also a problem in today's debate that they haven't dealt with in today's debate. No, thank you, right? So let's move on to my substantive matter where I'll be telling you like five reasons why representative democracy is better than direct representation. But first, COVID.
Why do you prefer Congress to repeal and replace Obamacare versus executive action?
Well, that's like a false comparison here, because we tell you that like we like the idea that like we can have like presidential prerogatives, right? So like we agree with both, right? The second of all, we tell you that like because we like Congress, because you can actively engage with the onus here was on proposition to tell us why Congress is insufficient.
Yes.
I've already told you that Obamacare wasn't repealed because you actually engaged with the fact that shit, we don't have an alternative that is good enough. Say democracy's functioning well without opposition, without governance model, right? So like, let's go back to the reasons as to why representative democracy is better than direct representation. First of all, Waris has already spoken about like political apathy, but also I want to talk about like why the media is specifically important in this role. Literally, only 52% of the American population voted in this election because they were overran by like Trump and Clinton issues, right? But CNN literally ran like 18 months of Trump and led to the victory. What you end up doing is overusing resources that like make people apolitically apathetic or feel as if like the power isn't in their hands. You maximize that harm when you have two elections with the exact same electioneering, with the exact same overproduction of the media, right? To that's incredibly problematic. But also it becomes even that more divisive, right? Where like the media companies not only have to run one election in terms of like being bipartisan, right? And then they also have to run another one in terms of policy utility, that like it becomes even more difficult to trust CNN in terms of like what their angle is in terms of this certain issue, right? So you think that like, yeah, some people might be cross-sectional in terms of like their policies, right? So they might be fiscal conservatives, but like liberal socially. Tell you that like, you start to separate the media in terms of like which policies they take on and whether they are bipartisan in that case, right? But the second reason is that we tell you that like bipartisanship still isn't removed, right? Could you tell you that people, especially in referendums, use things like the rule of thumb, right? So what is my neighbor saying about this issue? People don't actively engage that. You don't maximize political participation in their model. Thanks for coming, right? Healthy fault. Third reason is that like they leave it to other people because there's a sense, because it's a national referendum, right? They're like, oh no, if I don't vote, it's fine. My neighbor will do it for me, right? That's the same political apathy and the same like national referendum that messes up our elections in the first place. Fourth reason is that we've already talked about like time wasting, right? And the fact that like side government talks about how urgent it is and why we'd have this election. It's yes. Like that's quite ironic when your exact same model literally slows us down in terms of running the country, right? Yeah. You literally harm the urgency point that you're talking about, right? Thanks for coming, help before. The fifth reason is that it doesn't maximize accountability here. We say that like just because more people are voting for it doesn't mean that they own it, right? The same yes. person who voted in the referendum is still bitching about Brexit because they realize that the economy is fucked. Right? So you tell you that like fundamentally doesn't maximize accountability. Thanks for coming. But also we tell you that the most important thing, which is the extension from like Waris's matter, is the idea that we still have like in the status quo law protection, right? So we don't think that just because we need national referendums to protect people. Mexicans aren't being mass deported, yes. They're not building a wall, they're not like trampling on people's human rights because they still have like the Constitution. We still have like the Declaration of Independence. We still have all those mechanisms that protect people on the ground, especially in our status quo. So we tell you that we don't even need that mechanism to protect people and effect positive change in the government. Thanks for coming, right? So let's move on to like the harms analysis that like Waris has told you, and then I'll extend on it. He's already told you about like political apathy, whatever. But like preferably, the next point is the idea of like the wording of the referendum. We have already spoken about the fact that you call it Obamacare means that you've lost 60% of the population. I tell you, fundamentally, referendums are skewed and they take away political power from people. I'm happy to oppose.
Panel, this debate is about, do we prefer to give power to the people or power to Donald Trump? I think a blind vote of any rational actor would rather give it to the people, just to balance out the proclivities of Trump to change his mind on a night-to-night basis. Fundamentally, we don't desire a society where fundamental civil liberties change every 4 years. Let me give you a crystal clear example of an executive action that has been passed by Donald Trump and has now become part of the laws in the United States of America. Donald Trump has decided that Planned Parenthood should no longer be funded, and he has issued a decree to that effect. What does this actually mean? Because Planned Parenthood is actually not about family planning. It's about the right to be able to get contraceptives from the state, as well as abortions from the state. So fundamental civil liberties for women have been withdrawn by Donald Trump exclusively without the consultation or contribution of women. We find that particularly harmful. And that's what this debate is actually about. So when they tell you, and this is the first point of rebuttal, I'll be incorporating our rebuttal, when they tell you that, listen, this takes a long time, or this is expensive, we're okay with that. We think that fundamental capstone policies should not be overnight decisions. By the motion, by the info slide, this is a big decision for a state to take, because it's going to change the permutations and combinations for generations to come. We don't think that Trump can say, I want to do it within the first 100 days, let's get going, otherwise I'll be a lame duck president. This analysis is actually very duplicitous, because it makes it seem as if other laws, which are not capstone laws, cannot be passed. We're happy to take our time with the biggest laws that have the biggest impact and rush through the small laws that don't have as much impact. We think this is dishonest analysis that we got from the opening. So that deals with the first big objection that they give you around why we don't want this to happen from a time perspective or an expense perspective. We think that if it's costly, it's okay. It's an important legislation. I'm going to contextualize this a little bit further. Affordable Care Act gives provisions to pensioners around what kind of benefits they can get from Medicaid, right? If you change the benefits which exist from pensioners every 4 years, it makes it unstable for the markets to be able to participate in those pension schemes. It makes it unstable for those particular pensioners, because you plan your life on the basis of capstone policies. So how do I plan my 401k in the United States of America if the policy changes every 4 years? That's just not the way we do governance. Those are some of the inherent harms, right? Just wait a little bit. Okay, now I'm going to give you our two big legs of extension, and it's going to deal with a lot of the matter that came up in the first half. The first is the nature of the referendum versus the nature of an election, and why that deals with the rationality that was brought up. Because the reality is, a referendum is a specific question. A lot of time is spent educating the people on that specific question. A lot of time is spent advertising on that specific question. I think the Brexit debate, and I counted, had over 9 different debates on the question before the votes by people from all different sides. And it was covered by the media from all different angles. One specific question. That means that the fake news, the propaganda, the noise is easier to get rid of in the kind of a specific question. But also, it speaks to the rationality that they were talking about. When people vote in presidential elections, especially in countries such as the United States of America, a lot of people vote for Donald Trump. They're not voting for the issues. And a lot of issues are conflated, because Republicans run on a platform with over 100 bullet points, right? So to say that everybody who voted for the Republican Party voted for those particular bullet points is not necessarily true, because some people are for building a wall, but they're not for the denial of abortion, right? So it's not true to say that every Trump vote is for the same specific issue. You're reducing all Americans to binary figures. You're either for Trump and everything he stands for, or you're for Hillary and everything she stands for. Or I think Barack Obama said he was conservative on some issues, and he was moderate on others, and he was progressive on others, because human beings are complex, right? And that's very important. Now, I'm also going to come and tell you that in these kind of elections, when you are making a fundamental big decision as a president, it needs to be clear, keep standing, William, that you have the legitimate popular mandate. And what happens here is that the popular mandate is illegitimately imputed. I'm going to repeat this so you can extend, you can respond to this perfectly. The popular mandate is illegitimately imputed, right? So Donald Trump says, I won the election, the people want me to do this, right? But Donald Trump had 306 electoral votes, right?
Sure.
And Hillary Clinton had 63 million popular votes. When we're looking at what do the people want and what is the legitimate will of the people, we have to look at, in a democracy, it's majority of the views wins, not majority of the states win, right? So what we're trying to implement is, when it comes to civil liberties, we think that the best actor officer to decide what happens to them are the people who are directly affected by that. And we think we want to handle Trump saying that he has a popular mandate to do something when in fact he doesn't because of the complexity of the voting system. William Masela, give you the BY. Go ahead.
Do you not think it's easier, hold for 2 seconds, do you not think it's easier for Republicans to distance themselves from Donald Trump in Congress rather than have a referendum that prompts
them
to
go to London? Sit down, I'm not going to give you a speech because you always use that as a trick. Right, now, I'm going to answer this question, and this is the last leg of our extension, and it matters a lot. As an individual, as a woman, if your rights to contraceptives and abortion is being threatened, you're going to act in the most rational manner possible. However, Donald Trump is beholden to his billionaire friends, and he has been changing his policy positions on a night-to-night basis. Congress is beholden to massive interest groups called lobby groups.
Yes.
So even though American people want better gun control, Congress doesn't want it because they are funded by the National Rifle Association. So we don't think that Congress is the legitimate check when it comes to fundamental rights and fundamental determinations of the future of America. I'm going to give you another example of why Congress is particularly problematic. There is this phenomenon of corruption which exists in the United States of America called gerrymandering. Right? Where the Republicans have been able to deftly draw the lines of voting to exclude minorities or places where the majorities would vote against them. So even though Republicans lose popular elections in their voter constituencies, they win the seat in Congress because of the way they drew the map. What does this mean? It means it's an illegitimate check to the rights that exist for civilians. We prefer it to go to a referendum because of the specificity, irrationality of Trump, and buying of Congress by lobby groups. Thank you.
Very disingenuous that this side hasn't established the importance of capstone policies in their nature and why we like the fact that they're stagnant and very difficult to change. Because this is legislation that has socio-economic outcomes, and we feel like it's great that people can't change it overnight. It's great that you have to take years and years to compile the legislation and years to repeal it. And the fact that you need a large consensus in Congress to repeal that. We like the fact that for the most part, capstone policies are untouched. Secondly, we need to discuss the fact that this policy, this motion plays itself out specifically when there's an incoming presidential administration. That is to say when there's a transfer of power. So under your context, what happens is, we can use Donald Trump as an example. Donald Trump just is an example of an incoming presidential administration. Under your context, if you give people the right to use referendums to vote on these policies, you further amplify the sentiments of a right wing. The same right wing that voted for a president that wants to build the wall. The same right wing that wants to repeal Obamacare. The only reason why Obamacare is still around and the only reason why the wall hasn't been built is because we can debate it in Congress when you have Democrats to counteract those opinions, right? What you do is, when you allow for a referendum, you further amplify the same sentiments of the same America that would be willing to vote Trump into power. You don't do what you're saying, which is to protect. You need to account for the fact that the very example you use is an instance where there's a new presidential administration and how we're proving that under status quo, the sort of difficulty that comes with touching capital policies has actually insulated the sort of minorities that Trump wants to harm. Under your policy, you further allow that minority to have their sentiments amplified. Secondly, we think that it's very disingenuous that nobody has engaged the sort of detriment of repealing, what repealing means. Repealing means we have comprehensive specialists, we have specialists and technocrats who spend years drafting legislation, years compiling. It's reams and reams of paper, hundreds of pages, complex nuance matter that you want to undo over a yes or no decision based on a population that doesn't have the sort of specialist knowledge necessary to understand the socio-economic implications of repealing that legislation. It's things like environmental policies. The average Joe doesn't fully understand the economic outcomes and the diplomatic outcomes of changing environmental policies. Under your policy, you would give an average Joe the ability, so anyone over 18 really, to vote on something as crucial as environmental policies or policies around things like abortion, right? So our essential extent exists on the following level. We're going to give you a criteria for when or how we would compare the two. Secondly, we're going to give you a context under how in the context of incoming administration, you incur detriments. Lastly, we'll give you how the nature of referenda harms and undermines the ability for policymaking to be comprehensive. And lastly, how status quo has enough diversity of options to allow for meaningful political engagement from the public. Some outlying rebuttal. What we get from this side is the fact that we want to protect the minority from the sort of harms that are incurred when you don't allow the public to participate. We say when there's increasing opting into right-wing politics, you risk subverting progressive legislature that was instituted. You risk allowing the same people who are having increasingly xenophobic, increasingly conservative sentiments to directly influence legislation. We'd rather leave it up to the specialists. We'd rather allow robust debates where the sort of people we elect can represent us, right? So first point is just context, right? So this is how the policy is harmful under two contexts. When there's incoming administration that is a different party, but secondly, even when there's a new presidential candidate who's the same party as you, why this policy doesn't work. Under the instance of a shift from a democratic administration, so Obama to Trump, here's how it works. Instead of going through debates in Congress and extensively debating the merits of Obamacare, where Congress can call you out and say, we can't repeal a policy on the premise that it's named after someone, you're able to block Trump's egotistical desire to discard something because it's a legacy of his competitor, right? There's actual debate, which is why in Congress, Republicans can even distance themselves from Trump's sentiments and vote rationally considering the socio-economic implications, right? So under that context, when there's a president of a new party, you incur harm. But secondly, even if the president is still of the same party, presidents, when they're coming in, have an incentive to distinguish themselves from their predecessors. When you repeal something, it gives the population the impression that you're doing something meaningful, right? Yeah. So you have an arbitrary, like, calling of referendums, where you want to remove things for the sake of distinguishing yourself from whoever came before you. We know that politicians have fallen susceptible to this, and Trump is an instance. So we've shown you how in both transfers of power, where the transfer of power is from one party to another, but even in instances where it's just a presidential shift, you harm the majority, right? Secondly, the legitimacy of status quo as far as offering decision-making opportunities. We feel like we like the idea that under status quo, we defer our decision-making power to so people who have the expertise to understand the implications and mediate our interests. We like the idea that under status quo, the legislator we have is a moderate aggregate of what the average person feels. Under this policy, you can have extremely conservative policies or extremely liberal ones. Right. We don't like either of that. We like the fact that under current democracies, the sort of debate that happens in Congress allows for there to be a mediated aggregate of the sort of consensus and views that society has, right? Also, we get this idea that we like under status quo, the checks and balances ensure objectivity. Parliamentary debates means that even if you're a Republican who's Christian and conservative, the fact that we can debate leads you to become objective because you can see merits on the other side. The average person on the ground can't do that, right? So specifically the harms of referendum in the nation, right? First of all, we tell you that referenda have binary. Okay, Dlamini.
So listen, your policy makes it easier for presidents to change laws every time. Our policy actually makes it harder, fulfilling the thing that you say.
The reason why under status quo, Trump hasn't removed Obamacare despite desperately wanting to, is because you have this sort of robust engagement. It's because you don't allow the rest of American society to weigh in. The rest of American society supports Trump. They support conservatism. They support the building of the wall because they wouldn't have voted in a man who has that rhetoric if they didn't. You harm the minorities under your side. But specifically in their nature, how binaries are harmful. How referendum are harmful. First of all, they lead to binary options. By your own concession, the sort of legislature is complex. Referendum reduces to a binary. binary of yes or no.
Yes.
We don't think that complex policies can be understood in terms of do you support this or no, right? Planned Parenthood can't be just explained in a yes or no vote, right?
Mm.
So you lead to a vote that doesn't represent the complexity of these issues. Secondly, policies can be undone due to deviant sentiments in society. We don't care if the majority is xenophobic. We don't care if the majority hates women, right? We like the fact that under the status quo, you can't have those sentiments echoed, right? In South, if you had this policy, South Africa wouldn't have gay rights. Because as far as where we are morally and in terms of our value systems, we're a very homophobic nation. But because we have the capacity to override sentiments and defer that decision making to people who better understand, we have more inclusive policies that allow for a better standard of living, right? Lastly, under status quo, we have lobbying initiatives, we have petitions, we have meaningful engagements and things like review mechanisms where if you aren't accountable, we can vote in a next administration. What we don't like is reducing policies with that are meaningful to overnight decisions because you undermine the ability for us to have comprehensive policy making. But secondly, we subvert the very principle of...
Debating union, it's harmful when she says she doesn't care when people are homophobic, when people are xenophobic, and can institute those changes easily. Because that is what closing government actually cares about. Closing government cares about the degree to which these xenophobic, homophobic, and patriarchal views can be imparted on people. That is why, as closing government, we told you very specifically why it is important to have the highest degree of difficulty in overturning civil liberties, and that is why that is important. I asked opening opposition a very simple question. Do you care if it's Congress or Donald Trump who makes decisions? They didn't answer, so they're outside this debate. Because they didn't answer on a very critical question. What level of difficulty do we need to change civil liberties? Closing government actually tried, which was cute, but they still failed. Because they did say that Obamacare hasn't been replaced because Congress is debating it, and therefore his ability to change people's livelihoods has been compromised because now he has to do something about Congress. But what we tell you is that Capstone policies are so important that this difficulty should go beyond Congress, and that these affect people's lives so much more that they should go beyond that. Then they come and tell us right now that we are outsourcing this to specialists. For shame and bullshit. We are outsourcing this to populists who win elections by promising immigration law and then changing environmental law. We tell you that that is something that will bring you exclusive into closing government. Again, let me give you an extension that they have failed to engage completely.
Hear, hear.
The first issue is when they talk about binarism. That is the point. Like, when you vote for a candidate, you have between Hillary Trump and Donald. Remove that from the voting. So, but when you're voting on specific referenda, you're voting on immigration, you're voting on climate change, you're voting on Planned Parenthood, you're voting on all of these issues. And even Congress doesn't do that because you vote once for one Republican from your state who again make these decisions of climate change and all these issues. So they ignore that thermal elections do not look at the broad range of issues and why that is fundamentally important for this.
Yeah.
Secondly, they don't look at the issue of specificity. They say that language will win. For shame and bullshit. The motion says repeal, which means the policy actually exists in its exact wording, and you can actually look at it, which is very different from Donald Trump saying an abstract thing like, I'll replace and repeal Obamacare, and you haven't even seen the document that is going to replace that. We think that fundamental inability to actually understand these issues is important. But fundamentally and more importantly, and exclusively from closing government, we tell you that people don't make decisions on abstract speculation about what people are going to do. Law is prescriptive.
People make decisions about 401k based on what their accountant is going to tell them their money in the bank is, which is based on Obamacare, which means that the addition to laws is okay, right, and it needs a certain level of difficulty. But the reversal of laws that actually govern the way that we operate is fundamentally even more important. And that stability is achieved when you increase the difficulty at which people can change world laws, and that is fundamentally important. We told you that referenda is more representative than Congress, and they agreed that more representation is important because they said we shouldn't be beholden to Donald Trump's ego. And that is important, and that's why fundamentally we told you that. And lastly, and more importantly, wait, I'll tell you in a second. We told you of the legacy impact of Keystone policies. They're not 8-year ideas. I don't go at 40 and say, I want to plan for 65 and my next 25 years of retirement, and then someone after 8 years can change that. So we are okay with additions to civil liberties. Repeal means we remove civil liberties. The difference between the two is fundamentally important, and that's why the repeal and replacing of policies is something that we need to make very difficult.
Sir, Donald Trump doesn't act unilaterally. Congress is also being held by the constituents. That's why Republican town halls are going crazy.
So that's exactly what we said. We said that certain decisions should be made by executive action if they don't affect the general population to that extent. Certain decisions should be made by Congress because they are more important. And then the very, very important decisions should be made by referenda. That's exactly what we're talking about. And then she comes and says something so fundamentally offensive to me when she says that the average Joe shouldn't care. You know what? The average Joe is the one who's affected by climate change. The average Joe is the one whose cost assessment is not there. The average Joe is the one who cannot afford a pension. The average Joe is the one who's being shot down in the streets. The average Joe is the one who's being affected by all these policies. So for shame if you're going to tell me that I have no agency over my own health, over my own education, over my own environment, and over my own life. For shame. We need to be representative. And even more so, we tell you that when we talk about the technocratic effort that is made in making policies, it makes it even more important for us to make it difficult to change that. Because like they said in their opening, populism is important and lobbying is important in general elections. But what we tell you is that this populism is reduced when we have all the elections. Now let's go into the battle. Opening opposition just failed. They talk about cost. Donald Trump increased military spending by $50 billion and reduced amounts to environment and energy and all these issues. That money could have been better spent. $1 billion would have been enough to have referendum on all these issues and then provided more ability and values and rights to the people. They talk about stability, and we tell you that the stability is available when these people make those decisions better. They talk about, you know, cross-sectional. And this is exactly our point, that someone might want Donald Trump in terms of jobs, but doesn't want Donald Trump in terms of abortion. And that is exactly the point, that presidential and congressional elections are too binary for the issues that affect people and the level at which we're looking at in this debate. So, ladies and gentlemen, I just want to make something clear. As closing government, we talked about the importance of these policies to people's lives, and the way in which they affect us over a long term. And we told you that adding to civil liberties is fine, but removing civil liberties is not. And therefore, the repeal of civil liberties should have a different level of difficulty than the addition of civil liberties. That's why we're okay with Donald Trump signing 100 executive orders that will add civil liberties to everyone in the country, but we're very much harmed by one executive order that will mean the planet will go up by 4 degrees in 2050. That is harmful, and it harms all of us. We beg to propose.
panel, this debate is appropriately emblematic of the state of democracy in 2017. The fact that democratic spaces have become a polarizing space of misinformation and misleading rhetoric. Not once did we say that representative democracy was perfect. We acknowledged it has its flaws. But the bench on today's debate was the only side willing to do the comparative when we told you that on the comparative, it is far less preferable than direct democracy, which has a whole host of insurmountable outcomes. Two things I'm going to tell you. Firstly, I'm going to tell you the general problems of popular referenda. And secondly, I'm going to tell you the problems of having referenda for capstone legislation, us being the only side that engaged this idea in today's debate. And before I do that, I want to demystify this idea about which side is best for the relative stability of this legislation, right? Because it seems that they don't understand what repealing capstone policy means. Repealing capstone policy means repealing foundational policy that has been in existence for a long time. Things such as abortion rights decided by Roe vs. Wade in 1973 and the Affordable Care Act. We think what repealing then means is that you are going to have referenda that would easily make these decisions accessible to the public, which is far easier than status quo. Why? We think in status quo, we have designed barriers to easily repealing these policies because we understand their importance in their foundational, providing foundational stability to society and the fact that they decide a lot of functions. What are these barriers? We're talking about things such as legislative supermajority requirements in order to be able to repeal this policy. The fact that you can institute filibusters in order to prevent these things being repealed and replaced. The fact that if you contest the repealing of these policies, you can consult other arms of government, such as the courts. The difference that they allow for is they allow for presidents to arbitrarily decide when these policies need to be repealed and at the point in which that decision is made accessible to the public and a vote is made that is final. It becomes far easier. But secondly, it was very weird for the closing opposition, or the closing government rather, to argue in favor of having difficulty and saying that this would provide difficulty, considering that their opening team was all for making this the most accessible to these populations. We say that there's an inconsistency there. So, onto my clashes. What are the general problems of popular referenda? The first thing we told you on closing opposition is that there's an inadequate ability to gauge the preferences of your voters. What do we mean by this? We are telling you that when it comes to policies, the majority of voters don't contest policies in their entirety, but rather contest specific aspects of those policies. The problem with referenda is that they are framed in such a manner in which you either have to accept or reject the policy in its entirety, which we say isn't even an accurate reflection about what your preferences are. Why do we think on the comparative it is far better when we have representative democracy? Now, they misconstrued Mpilo's words. Mpilo's words weren't that the average Joe doesn't know what he or she wants, but rather that the average Joe is in a position where they can indicate their broad preferences, because we say that's exactly what term elections allow you to do when you choose an elected representative. The job then of an elected representative is to try and negotiate what those interests are along with the interests of everybody else. And we think that's precisely why we prefer representative democracy and when you can choose an elected representative. We think we protect the average Joe person more. But the second general problem that actually undermines the average Joe is that direct democracy and referenda in particular allows for the tyranny of the majority. That is to say that if a decision is made that is brought in by the majority within an election that undermines a minority interest, the decision is final, rather than having parliamentary processes that allow for safeguards to make sure that the interests of the minority are being protected, such as requiring super majorities in parliament for those things to pass. We think there's no response to this. The second thing we say you enable is a climate of misinformation and misleading rhetoric. What we are talking about is packing complex legislation that took more than 20 to 30 years to draft into a single election period. We don't think that you can provide an accurate account about the complexity of this legislation, and we think that a climate of misinformation is likely going to exist within a specific circumstance, and we think that that makes it difficult for voters to adjudicate whether or not these policies or repealing these policies are in their interests. But secondly, we think the misinformation is likely going to happen when it comes to keystone legislation, because when you are repealing referenda, all a political party has to do is not to argue for the merits of any replacement they're going to provide, but rather to discredit and cast sufficient doubt on the existing policy. That is exactly what the Leave campaign did during Brexit,
okay.
Completely
yes.
Lambasting, staying the European Union without providing an idea of what would happen next. That is precisely the harm that you entrench when you have this policy in place. The third thing that our opening told you is that you have heightened voter apathy. The fact that you have repeated election cycles, a lot of voters are specifically going to opt out because of Tamsi Tyson, and I'm going to show you later why it specifically hurts minorities. So, second clash, problems with Capstone election referendum. Quickly, Jamie.
We tell you the problem with elected representatives is firstly that they are captured by special interests, and secondly that gerrymandering has happened and they are not representative.
So those are arguments for reform for representative democracy, which we think we can implement. But the reason why we think in parliamentary processes you're unlikely to be captured by specific interests is you are accountable to your constituents.
Yes.
So in a position which you fail to provide for them, you're going to lose the next election. But why do we think when we make decisions or referendum capstone elections, it's particularly harmful? The first thing we told is that it entrenches partisanship. Generally, when you're making decisions in parliaments, party politicians can understand that this legislation goes beyond them and the fact that it addresses and affects the whole society. So they're far more willing to make compromises on this legislation. And even if they don't make compromises, they're unlikely to contest legislations wholesalely because they understand that it's difficult to repeal them and replace them using parliament as a process. The problem when you allow this to public referendum is you now remove that. You entrench partisanship because firstly, it becomes an opportunity to consolidate power. We say that elections generally are an antagonistic event.
Yes.
And at the point when you're having an election, you're going to be prompted as a politician to vote or promote the party line that you support. So even if you're a Republican that disagrees with Trump's policies, during this period, you're going to be forced to side with the Republicans and promote a single united party line because that's exactly what elections entrench. But secondly, we say that what this allows for presidents and incoming governments after a change of power happens from one party to another party, because that's a specific context we're discussing, what it allows for is for presidents to arbitrarily choose to repeal specific legislation because that becomes an opportunity for legacy. That is what Mfilo told you, that usually we associate presidencies based on the mass policy initiatives they either promoted or repealed. And at the point in which it becomes easier for you to repeal a policy, that becomes an opportunity for you to have an association with your presidency. So to consolidate power, you now have a perverse incentive to arbitrarily repeal legislation for the sake of doing so. And you're likely to win because you're going to use the election victory momentum you had from the previous term election to get the win here. And that is damaging. Ladies and gentlemen, it's for these reasons that I'm very proud to oppose.
Okay.